Oh, and you know what it is from the title. Let's start off with the zoom, adding so much production value. Maybe next week you'll get sound. You'll get music and backgrounds and fireworks and intros and all sorts of cool shit. Probably not, though. As you know from the title, we're going to be talking about the Piranha Predator automatic knife today. So before I say much more about it, I'll just go ahead and put the disclaimer out there. Many of you already know that automatic knives are illegal to own in several states. I happen to live in one of the amazing states that allows me to own this, this and many other automatic knives. So without further ado, look at how fast that thing opens up. Isn't that a thing of beauty? So Piranha is a USA-owned company, and this is a USA-produced knife, which is really awesome. And I'm going to get to one of the reasons why that's really awesome in a little bit, and that's the price of this knife. Just start right out and jump right in. This is an automatic knife, as it says. It has a 4.1-inch blade made out of S30V blade steel, which is one of the more premium blade steels. Takes an edge really well, at least in my experience. Holds an edge decently. The overall length of the knife is 9.1 inches, and it weighs 4 ounces. 4 ounces is an amazing weight, in my opinion, for an automatic knife with a 4-inch blade. It comes black coated. I think all of their knives actually come black coated with these anodized aluminum 6061 T6 handle, T6 6061 or 6061 T6, however you want to say it, aluminum handles, position for tip up carry. It has the Piranha Fish, their logo, actually milled into the side of the aluminum, which is pretty cool. And it's really an outstanding automatic knife for the price. So let's go ahead and just start by talking about the blade. As we said, it's a S30V blade, 4.1 inches in length. Nice slender blade, though. It's not a really thick slab of S30V, and you don't really need it, in my opinion, for an automatic knife for defense purposes or just EDC. You don't really need a big, hefty, fat blade. It has a nice gentle blade sweep here, nice little bit of belly here, flat ground about halfway up to the spine here, and has an unsharpened swedge across the top. The tip is, I'm going to try and zoom in here on it, is surgical. I mean, this is a delicate, extremely pointy, extremely sharp tip. If you're going to try and do any kind of prying with this, which I wouldn't recommend you doing with an automatic knife anyway, you're probably going to bend it. For me, I end up doing more delicate cutting than I do prying with my knives, so the delicate tip really isn't an issue. I'm not really terribly worried about bending or breaking that tip off. It does have a tiny bit of side-to-side blade play, no up and down blade play whatsoever, but a tiny bit of side-to-side, and I'm told that these automatic knives will have a tiny bit of blade play because of the firing mechanism and how they have to actuate and so on. Not at all, you know, not clunky at all. You can't hear it click, but there is a tiny bit of side to side, and I just thought I'd let you know that ahead of time. You've got a kind of an oblong cutout hole here and the spine, which is really just for aesthetic reasons. Well, I should say for aesthetic reasons, and it also provides this upswept piece here for a nice tiny run of jimping. Not Spyderco, not a Spyderco full spider hole run of jimping, but enough. Enough jimping with your index finger and your thumb to get a nice purchase on the knife, in my opinion. To me, this knife is, and people might call it a tactical knife because it's 4 inches and so on. To me, it's really an elegant carry knife. It's a big knife, but it's made with really nice, elegant handle design and all of these little features in it. And one of the things I think they have done is tried to make the handle as smooth and not have a lot of occlusions or screws sticking out of it. And with that, you'll notice that there is no pivot screw. So that might be an issue. I've been carrying this knife for about three months now. I haven't had any issues with this blade really becoming loose or anything, but there isn't any way for me, at least externally, to adjust that pivot in this blade. So it might be a miss, might not. I might have to, if I have an issue later on down the road, I'll go ahead and update this video and let you know. But all keeping with that design, you'll notice that the screws are very, very small, and there are not very many of them. So they really kind of melt away into the anodizing on this knife. I went ahead and chose the blue model. All of them come with a black blade, as far as I know. It comes in blue anodized, black, plum, orange, green, and I believe tan. So you've got your choice of colors there. You'll notice if we start looking at the handle, and again with this run of jimping being not a very big thumb ramp, it's kind of cool for keeping again the elegance to this blade. So it doesn't really put this big thumb ramp here like you would have in some of the Spyderco's. Keeps the overall knife very slender. The actuating button, or the firing mechanism right here, you'll notice that if I zoom in, if I bring it up to the camera, that you're dished out right here, so your thumb can find it very easily in the dark or in your pocket or however you're trying to actuate your knife and just fire that blade right out. Now, one of the nice things about this type of design is with this dished out area for a button, for the actuating button on automatic knives, at least in my opinion, is if I put this knife down and I push on it, it's not going to fire on its own. It actually needs that bit of pressure to push inside of that dished out area right there to fire the blade. So you don't have to give me a safety, you don't have to give me anything to make me worry about firing this thing off in my pants. No puns intended there. Just design the button well. To the manufacturers out there that may be watching this, probably none because I am like a YouTube newbie. Just design the button well and where the button's placed, and that's all the safety you need. At least that's all the safety that I ever need. Now, talking about the handle, we said that it's blue anodized aluminum. You'll see that if I turn this knife up like this, that the handle's very narrow right here toward the blade, and it swells out towards the palm area. It's another really nice design, in my opinion. I have a nice narrow handle right here where I'm going to pinch with my index finger and my thumb, but the palm swell area is going to fill my hand and give me a really good purchase on this knife. Wherever I move my hand, that tip's going to go, and so on. So a really nice design feature there, really subtle. You can't tell at all by looking at it from the side. You turn it on the end, here, you'll see that it's just swelled out just a little bit. You get a bit of jimping towards the end of the knife here, which I would say is primarily for if you were doing a reverse grip. You can get your thumb right on there. Now, I'm not sure how many of you guys out there are actively using reverse grips on your knives, unless you're a professional knife fighter or you really are living in a bad area and you get into a lot of knife fights. I'd say that's more of a novelty than anything for most of us. We're probably not going to end up in a knife fight in our lifetime, and if we do, are we going to be good enough to use a reverse grip? I'm not sure. I probably won't be. Let's turn this thing over and talk about the pocket clip. Now, when I first saw this in pictures, I was a little bit worried that there was a single screw holding the pocket clip in, and I thought that this pocket clip would swivel left and right, and this knife would dangle all loose in my pocket, and so on. If I bring it up to the camera, though, you'll see that the pocket clip is recessed into the handle, which is really an awesome design. And I think they did this again to keep this handle really very aesthetic and not have a lot of big screws and other screws and stuff, not make it very technical looking. That single screw holds the clip in the recess perfectly. The pocket clip's adequately strong. Actually, it was a little bit too strong. When I first got it, I had to take it off and bend it so that it would go in and out of my pocket easier. The texturing on the handle is similar to G10. It's similar to what a G10 texture would be, but being that it's a blue anodized aluminum, it's pretty smooth still, and it gives you a little bit of traction, but not much. Not like a really good grippy G10 would be, and to me, that's not really an issue. Again, most of my grip is coming from my index finger and my thumb for most cutting tasks that I'm doing, and I don't find that scale texture on the sides really adds a whole lot for me. Maybe if I was fighting with this knife or I was wearing gloved hands, that would be a bigger issue, but for me, not really a huge issue. And I prefer this knife exactly how it is, to be a nice, elegant, smooth looking blade. Go ahead and show it to you there on the camera. Now, one of my criticisms with this knife is this point at the end of the handle here. Now, you could see just by kind of looking here how deep this thing's going to ride in pocket. It's not going to be a super deep carry knife. And if I go ahead and show you here with my mat, just how deep this is going to carry to give you an idea, you're going to have this pyramid sticking out of the top of your pocket. And to me, I don't know if it's just me or what, but I think that looks funky. I don't really like that at all. I'd rather have a squared off end sticking out of the top of my pocket than this pyramid. It might just be a personal preference thing, I'm not sure. If this handle was a little bit more squared off, it would add a tiny bit of weight, yes, but I would gladly take that weight and move that pocket clip a little bit deeper to give me a deep carry on this knife. So I wanted to go ahead and show that. And that's one of my only major criticisms with that, is I don't like how that looks coming out of my pocket. Very cool little knife. So, as I said, this is an American-made knife at the beginning, and the price point, mid-$100 range. So, $150 to about $170 is an outstanding value, at least in my opinion, for an automatic, USA-produced knife with a 4-inch blade out of S30B steel. I mean, really fantastic price point. I mean, compared to Microtex or any of the other manufacturers, USA-made manufacturers that are providing automatic knives, especially out of this high-quality steel, and with this kind of machining and attention to detail, that's an outstanding price point. Maybe too much for some guys, but for us who collect knives and are just totally knife crazy, that's pretty hard to beat. One thing I forgot to mention, and I just saw it, is you do get a nice run of jimping in both of the finger areas here. So both finger areas have a nice bit of sharp jimping in there. Not too sharp, but my index finger and my middle finger just fall naturally right into those. So the handle is very, very ergonomic in both the standard type grip and really in the reverse grip as well. So I think that's about most of the things I have to say about it. Really can't go wrong if you're looking for what I would consider an affordable automatic knife, especially one with a blade this big. You really can't go wrong with Piranha. Definitely check out the Piranha Predator or any of the other Piranha knives, I would say, for that matter. Anyway, this has been another video from me, Mac the Knife 801. Stay sharp.